I would like to thank to Professor Evangelia Balte and Richard Wittmann for introducing me and inviting me to give this special lecture. I have many questions actually, but I have to be fast because Evangelia Balte instructed me. Can we talk about Ottoman cinema? If you focus on cinema only in film production, it can be difficult to use this term. Why? Because only a few full-length fiction films were produced in the Ottoman Empire, and we have just short of pieces them now. Many short films, documentaries, and reels are lost. But in my opinion, the usage of the term Ottoman cinema is possible. If you talk about it in terms of cinema criticism, cinema audience, movie theaters, and generally in the frames of cinema culture. This cinema was a seed form until World War I. During the war, it began to grow, and finally, between the years 1917 and 1919, it began to grow. There was a live cinema culture during this period. In this period, because of increasing local productions, the number of audience and the first fiction movies, particularly Istanbul, was the epicenter of the Ottoman cinema culture. My presentation will focus on this period. But before focusing these years, I would like to give some short information about Ottoman cinema. Then I will delineate the details of the years from 1917 to 1919. I would like to show some movie scenes and short films produced during these years. Cinema in the Ottoman world until 1970. The first movie screening in the world happened in 1895, and 1 year later, in 1896, we witnessed the first film screening in Istanbul. As Nezih Erdoğan said, cinema received a warm welcome in Istanbul. Neither the state nor society showed any significant resistance to cinema. Cinema was introduced largely by non-Muslim cosmopolitans in Istanbul. A French illusionist, Bertrand, made a screening short films for the residents of the palace. The first public screenings were realized by a painter, Henri Delaval. He showed Lumière films in Salon Sponek, a well-known beer house in Istanbul, where the commercial value of cinema was immediately understood. A Romanian Jew from Poland, Zygmunt Weinberg, stood at the center of film business. He opened the first movie theater near Pera and made many short films. The number of movie theaters increased during the World War I. In 1914, the demolition of the monument of San Stefano, Hagia Stefanos Tarus Abidesi'nin yıkılışı, was shot by a Turkish soldier and filmmaker Fuat Uzkunay. Some Turkish cinema historians claim that this film is a Turkish movie, but it is a controversial idea. In fact, before 1914, the Ottoman citizen Maraki brothers made many short films in the Ottoman Empire. Maraki brothers filmed the Ottoman bureaucrats and the Sultan. They made more than 40 short films during the Ottoman Empire. That is why the claims about the Turkish film is a very problematic idea. I do not want to enter this topic. Instead, I would like to focus on the years from 1970 to 1919. As I mentioned before, during this period, some dramatic changes occurred in cinema culture. First, let me start the film production and screening. Then I am going to explain audience and cinema criticism. Film production and screening. The Ottoman press didn't regard the demolition of the monument of San Stefano neither the first Ottoman or Turkish film, nor the beginning of Doku national cinema. Ottoman writers, journalists, and newspapers mentioned the local cinema with the feature films dated 1970. According to them, local cinema begins with the local themed feature films of 1970. These films were regarded as the first step towards the foundation of the local cinema industry. San Stefano was never mentioned in this text. Probably the writers of the time thought this film was just another newsreel. The first Ottoman feature film was Spy, Casus. And the second was Bijan Efendi Municipal Inspector, Bijan Efendi Belediye Müfettişi. They were produced in 1917. And Spy was a spy adventure and drama, whereas Bijan Efendi was a comedy. Unfortunately, we don't have any available copies of these films. In fact, in 1914, the Society of National Defense, Milli Müdafaa Cemiyeti, opened its own movie theater in Şehzadebaşı, and in 1917 opened its own movie founded a studio in order to make fictional films. A drama film, Spy, Casus, and a comedy film, Bijan Efendi, Belediye Müfettişi, were made in this studio. These films were shown to Ottoman audience in Beyoğlu in 1970. Secondly, another drama, Klo, Pençe. And the second comedy, Bijan Efendi, Sick Leave, Bijan Efendi, Tebdili Havada, were filmed. They were shown in movie theaters in Beyoğlu and then screened at different places. There were three different types of films together in the screening program: a documentary or newsreel, a comedy film, and a drama. Bijan Efendi New Rich and Bijan Efendi In Pursuit of Money, Bijan Efendi Yeni Zengin ve Bijan Efendi Para Peşinde were the third and fourth part of comedy series. They were slapstick comedies and first shown in Beyoğlu in 1918. Spy, Casus, is nearly 1 hour, whereas Klo is longer. The producer of these films was the Society of National Defense. Sedat Simav was the director of these films. Actors were from Darül Bedai, artists from Darül Bedai, meaning the Institute of Fine Arts. It's important to emphasize the significance of World War in terms of Ottoman cinema. According to German film and cultural theorist Krakauer, the emergence of German cinema was only after World War I. The certain contribution of war to German cinema was the preparation of a generation of actors, cameramen, directors, and technicians for the duties of future. Similarly, the future years of Ottoman Turkish cinema was based upon war years. One of the most distinctive features of this period was the tendency to make fiction films. Fiction films naturally require more complex knowledge, equipment, and cast. These films were made and presented to the Ottoman audience in the second half of 1917 and continued in 1918 and 1919. Film production continued after the war. Ottomans tried to build their own fictional world in a time when most empires, along with Ottoman Empire, were collapsing. No matter how destructive and difficult the conditions were, transition to local fiction films production was realized in 1917 and continued in 1919. Of course, we cannot talk about an Ottoman cinema industry, but its foundation was laid. While Ottoman Empire was collapsing, something new was rising above it. Now, let's see some knowledge about the first local productions from a documentary, Bırakın Çocuk Oynasın. Let the child play. I would like to thank to Hacı Mehmet Duranoğlu, the director of the movie, for giving it to me for this special lecture. We may think that during the occupation period, meaning between 1918 and 1922, film production will stop, we may think it. But contrary to common sense, particularly in 1919, both fiction and documentary Ottoman productions increased. Let me clarify it. In fact, the Entente powers, İtilaf Devletleri, wanted to ban the screenings of movies of Allied powers, meaning Germany, Austria-Hungary, and Bulgaria. In fact, during the World War I, the Union and Progress Party and the German intelligence agency in Istanbul banned the display of British, French, and Russian movies in the country. Now, during the occupation period, the Entente powers made some prohibitions on screening of Allied powers. The Entente powers at Beyoğlu began to take strict measures on entertainment places. Entente powers at Beyoğlu banned the theaters, music halls, as well as movie theaters, and they would be allowed to remain open until midnight. After this time, no one should be found in these buildings. The second prohibition was on Ottoman fiction movie, The Governess, Mürebbiye, in 1919. Let me talk a bit on this censorship. There were two organizations capable of making films in the occupied Istanbul. One of them was Sigmund Weinberg's Cinema Manufacturing, and the other was a charity organization called Society of Disabled Veterans, Malum Gaziler Cemiyeti. The Governess is the first fiction film of this society's film factory. Ahmet Fehim directed this movie. Unfortunately, there is no available copy of the film, but some visual materials can be found at the Turkish Land Forces Photo Film Center in Ankara. And let me show this short piece, Mürebbiye. The protagonist of the film, Angel, is an attractive French governess. She tutors two children of a wealthy family, Ottoman family. Angel becomes an object of desire for the man at family's mansion. But on the grounds of the French are being humiliated, But on the grounds of the French are being humiliated, the French general Franche has made difficulties in the releasing of the film and stops the film sending to Anatolia. But he couldn't completely stop the release of this film. Some Turkish cinema historians claim that the governess, Mürebbiye, implied the passive resistance to the occupied powers. But the attempt of stopping the release in Anatolia does not make this film a tool of protest against occupation forces. Moreover, today there is no available copy of the film, and even the intertitles were not preserved. The governess introduces a foreign governess who was a stereotypical subject and characterization found in the literature of the time. In fact, the film was based on author Hüseyin Rahmi Gürpınar's well-known novel of the same name. However, there is no hard evidence to determine how closely the film followed the original source. In fact, Gürpınar's novel was a criticism against the Ottoman Turkish families who imitated Europe at the time. Angel is portrayed as morally corrupt, whereas the Turkish men are depicted as victims of a foreign woman. Okay. After the governess, the Society of Disabled Veterans made the second fiction movie, Binnaz, in 1919. Some pieces of this film have survived to the present. Mimar Sinan University Center of Cinema and TV restored it. Originally, the film lasts 45 minutes. but this version only runs for 19 minutes. The film is about love story. Binnaz is a young and beautiful woman. She is in love with Efe Ahmet, a Janissary named Efe Ahmet. Binnaz is a prominent courtesan in Istanbul, and her fame is well known throughout Balkans. At the end, Efe Ahmet captures Binnaz's heart after some troublesome events. The film includes magnificent views from Topkapı Palace and scenes in Istanbul. Fuat Uskunay handled the camera and Mademoiselle Blanche played the lead role of Binnaz. As an object of desire for men, Binnaz is similar to common representation of woman characters as femme fatale, among other films of the time. She is similar to Angel in The Governess. Although now in bits and pieces of available copies, Binnaz still catches the viewer's attention with its provocative love story, elaborate customs, and well-chosen location shots. The film used the themes of love, jealousy, friendship, and heroism. Since there was no protest against the occupation forces in the movie, there was no difficulty in the film's screening. Now, let's see some pieces of this film. I don't want to make an analysis on this film because I don't have time. In order to increase the box office value of the film, the Society of Disabled Veterans conducted an effective promotional campaign despite the negative conditions at that period. In addition to the theatrical plays popularity, the film has achieved a serious box office. According to Nurullah Tilgen, the movie cost 5,000 liras, but only in Istanbul the revenue was 55,000 liras. And 5,000 liras were also obtained from the screenings abroad. Other than feature films, I would like to talk about some demonstration films in 1919. After the occupation of Izmir by the Greeks, the people of Istanbul reacted greatly to this invasion. The people were asked to participate in the protest rallies to be held with the distribution of leaflets. The first protest rally was held in Fatih on May 10. On May 23, the Sultanahmet rally was to be held, in which Halid Edip could also attend as speaker. The Society of Disabled Veterans shot it. Cemil Filmer, who filmed the Sultanahmet demonstration, described that day from his memory as, let me read it. It was clear that the people of Istanbul should show a big resistance to this occupation. Whispers spread from year to year. Finally, one day the leaflets were distributed, a rally was to be held. The day before that, Fuat Uskunay told me, Cemil, prepare the machine and the field. Tomorrow, Lady Halide will speak at the rally, and only ladies will be attending that rally. You will go to Sultanahmet Square and film this rally. I was excited. I couldn't sleep that night. I got up at dawn. I had already checked my preparation in the evening. I went right to Sultanahmet. The square was full. Women are in a black sheets. Some of them had open napkins there in their hands. The walls of the surrounding buildings were painted red. Only the flags of white crescents were kept hanging. I crossed the crowd with difficulty and went to one of the minarets of the mosque. Now I could see the whole area. There I made a panoramic shot by placing the machine on the railing of minarets. The British didn't want the rally to be filmed. Fuat Bey warned me. I got out of the minaret before they could see me and I tried to get close to the podium where the Lady Halide was speaking. I also wanted to take a closer shot. After completing the closer shots, I moved directly to the center of organization. Till midnight, we developed and printed the film. Now I want to show a piece of visuals taken from this rally. Cinema historian Dr. Özdeçim Çelikteman Thoman gave it to me. I am grateful to her. She got this visual from the American archive. There is no voice because it is silent cinema. As you see, there are some closer shots, and people are sometimes looking at us, the camera. They are very excited and they would like to be seen. As you remember, in the memory of the Cemil Filmer, he said that just only women were participating in this rally, but as you see in the cinematic history, women and men are side by side. Probably his argument, Ekrem Tarlu, 2,000 people gathered together in this rally. 200,000. If you wish, I can give these visuals to you. Now I want to pass another subject, which comprises in itself another dimension of Ottoman cinema. Cinema criticism. We can divide these criticisms into a few categories. Some of these are cinematographic and technical, some criticisms are social and cultural. When we look at the technical ones, one of the fundamental criticism is the lighting. There is a general opinion that the light is not enough in these films and they look dark. There is also a problem of montage. Some parts of these films are longer than they should be, and some parts are shorter than they should be. Of course, we are still talking about silent cinema, and one of the most important necessities of this period was intertitles. There are some criticisms about intertitles. These intertitles can be seen well. They are too dark to be seen. There isn't enough time to see them. The critics also talk about the colors and shaping the colors. There are also some problems occurred during the filming process, like some people that shouldn't be in the frame. Now, let me show some details of this criticism. Despite these kinds of criticism, the perspectives of Ottoman intellectuals towards cinema was positive. The first local productions were taken with great interest and took part in journals and magazines. Ottoman intellectuals passionately supported the transition to local cinema, local production. However, they didn't like the first films in terms of their plots and found them unsuccessful cinematographically. Now I would like to pass to the last dimension of Ottoman cinema. Movie spectators or watchers. It is understood from the writings published in the press in the years between 1917 and 1919 that there was a huge interest towards cinema and a big audience was formed. The screenings of the first Ottoman films were sought after with great interest. According to some writers, Ottoman people started to regard cinema as one of the best sources of entertainment, just like people did in other parts of the world. Hundreds of people were filling movie theaters to watch local productions. The people were happy with the results of the local cinema. They watched every part carefully and exchange opinion the films. According to Sabah, Iqdam and Tanin writers, cinema spread very fast and became part of the daily life. Refik Halit Karay was writing in 1918 that each neighborhood had a movie theater and day by day they were getting full. Another point that I would like to point out is that women showed great interest towards cinema. Why? In that period, it could be observed that there were more women in the streets. And the author of Iqdam believed that there were some basic reasons of this case. the duties of the woman increased in the society, and they took over new roles due to the war. Also, women who did not have husbands, brothers, or fathers near them had to go out on their own to meet their needs. Also, women noticed the cinema. According to the İhtan journal author, women discovered a new pastime. Actually, watching films turned into a kind of need for the woman. Many women seen in the streets were either going to or returning from the cinema. In 1919, even if in few numbers, some college girls attended the Cinema Bureau of the Society of Disabled Veterans in order to learn about cinema notion. Maybe this was one of the first indicators showing that cinema culture is beyond the dimension of watching an audience. Women were addicted to going to cinema, so much so that when in this December 1918, movie theaters were closed for a few weeks due to an epidemic, caused a serious distress for women. Nezihe Rikat, one of the witnesses of the period, actually I have sent this PowerPoint new version to the technicians, but unfortunately he didn't download the new version. I wanted you to read Nezihe Rikat's memory. Okay, I can read it. Nezihe Rikat, one of the witnesses of the period, said in an article on the subject, "The cinemas have been closed for a few weeks because of the disease. Can't you see the ladies in Beyoğlu, Kadıköy, Şehzadebaşı, whose eyes were dazzled, heads turned, half drunk, filling up the streets? In the evenings, the trams used to immediately start distributing cinema enthusiasts to the cities. Among them were stylish, elegantly dressed young girls, middle-aged ladies covered in veils, school-aged, highly mannered widows, rich, poor, well-versed, ignorant. There were members from every section of the society. I think for a few weeks all the ladies were yawning in great boredom in front of their mirrors. Many of the colleagues, mostly female friends, confessed to me that they missed the cheerfulness and feel emptiness and walk without cinema. Nothing amuses me anymore. I have become short-tempered, irritable and ill-mannered. Those who do not hide their feelings from me in this style are very distinguished and now noble ladies." She was writing in 1918 in a journal. Some writers were criticizing the behaviors of cinema spectators. While watching movies, they were starting and stopping, applauding at the wrong time. While leaving the salons, they are described as exhausted with tired eyes. How was the audience hearing about films? Posters were put on the walls of the streets. Daily newspapers advertisements were announcing the movies. And finally, news spreading from mouth to mouth made all the cinema fanciers rush to movie theaters. Printed media was the most practical and proper way of spreading news and advertising things. And conclusion. As historian Eric Hobsbawm says, the success of cinema was amazing because it reached millions in a very short time. Since there was no language or education barrier in front of cinema, it was adopted by masses easily and fast. In the Ottoman Empire, cinema was a seed for until World War I. During the war, this seed grew, and particularly between the years from 1917 to 1919, the Ottoman fiction movies blossomed. There was an increasing popularity of cinema. in Istanbul as in other countries. The number of people coming to cinema was remarkable. Indeed, cinema became a part of daily life for ordinary people. Cinema was a cheap entertainment since the very beginning. The feature continued during the years of occupation. Most of the people were able to save money for the cinema, even though life was expensive and suffering from unemployment. In this period, cinema became an indispensable element that made people forget the occupation, opened the doors of free world, gave hope, entertainment, and happiness. From 1917 to 1919, cinema indeed became a profitable business. During this period, people thought cinema was a need or obligation, like reading newspapers. I emphasize that because of the increasing popularity of the cinema, during this period, cinema found a place in the newspapers. When the war extended, people were really depressed, and the best way to escape from the reality of the time was cinema. Then I can claim that this tendency towards cinema was normal. It also can explain the tendency towards comedy films. As I explained before, Bijan Efendi was a comedy series. And during the 1917-1919 period, at least these four slapstick comedies were made. People showed great interest to these comedies. Comedies were one of the best way of escaping from real life. Not only in the Ottoman world, but also all around the world, comedy films were common. During the period, other than love, crime, adventure films, comedy films also increased. Also, comedy films could touch the social problems. Towards the end of the World War, comedies such as Bijan Efendi, New Rich, Bijan Efendi, Yeni Zengin, and Bijan Efendi in Pursuit of Money, Bijan Efendi, Para Peşinde, implied the social problems. During the wartime, there was inventory stockout, and prices began to climb dramatically. The term of war rich became popular in literature, cartoons, and in newspapers. So did in cinema. We don't have any copy of war rich films, comedy films, but by considering their title, we can guess that they focused on this issue. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I would start off the discussion by asking two tiny questions myself. You covered so much ground in your presentation, but I was wondering about, first of all, do we know more about the production, the filmmaking? Was there a kind of film school, or were the filmmakers all self-trained? That's one aspect. And the other one is, was Ottoman film really the first kind of film that moviegoers in Istanbul would see, or was there already French film, English film, American film before Ottoman film shown in the cinemas of Istanbul?
Ottomans were raised by other filmmakers. In the Ottoman world, as I have mentioned in my presentation, before the Ottoman Turkish people, Ottoman citizens, Manaki brothers and other people, filmed sultans and bureaucrats and some other things, daily life, for example. And over time, because of the national politics and economic politics, economical interests, and also, the Union and Progress Party took over the politics of the government of the Ottoman Empire, and they wanted to raise the filmmakers. And it was a choice of them. But before them, as you mentioned, there were other local productions, there were other foreign filmmakers. But generally, they were Ottoman citizens. But sometimes some travelers coming from Europe and other countries took some visuals and presented to the Ottoman audience and Western people, Western audience, I mean. And it is a mix. Actually, we don't have so much information about Ottoman cinema. There are a few people who try to search this topic, but a few people, including Nezih Erdoğan, Özde Çelik Temel, and including myself, try to do some things, but many things are not clear. We have to do research about this issue. But as you know, Fuat Uskunay was a soldier and filmmaker. But in the film, I mean, Ayastofanas'ta Rus Abidesi'nin yıkılışı, the demolition of the monument of San Stefano, was taken by Fuat Uskunay and another foreign filmmaker. But we don't know the name of the filmmaker. There is not so much clear about some issues, I mean.
If I may, what is remarkable is that the films are, the producers, actually, must have been very familiar with what is happening in Europe. Because they must have been watching a good deal of foreign films. Looking at them, you wouldn't think that there's any difference from a French or even an American. The acting, the staging, the production, the camera work is extremely universal, which is remarkable. Yes. Can't be just started then.
Right.
So there must have been indeed an audience watching films from abroad at the time, and so on.
Yes, that is why I claim that there was an Ottoman cinema culture during this period. Cinema culture is beyond the film production. There must be, film criticism. There must be some arguments over the issue. Interestingly, I am very surprised when I see this kind of discussions. Today, there are many Turkish films, but when I read articles and some reviews, I cannot see these detailed and argumentative expressions. But interestingly, during this time, because of the intelligentsia or something, I don't know the reason of it, but there must be, there was a live cinema culture.
Where are the cinema?
Where are the cinema?
How many cinemas were there in 1900, 1910,
1920? There were different types of places which would screen the cinemas, films. One of them is movie theaters. Movie theaters were specially organized. But according to statistics, until 1922, probably 22 or 24 movie theaters in Istanbul. But other than movie theaters, 22 or 23. Other than movie theaters, there were different places, like theaters, music halls, and coffee houses, literary houses, this kind of places were screening movies. And also, as I mentioned in my PowerPoint presentation, in the palace there was a movie screening. Not only in the movie theaters, but also other places. People could go to cinemas to watch local productions or other productions.
Hodge, I couldn't quite hear. Did you say in 1922 there were about 23 or 24 cinemas?
Yes.
And do you know what the figure was in 1910?
According to Nezih Erdoğan, if I'm missing, I am not sure, but probably 14 or 15. But after the lesson, if you give your email, I can send it.
No, I think it makes the, it, in a sense, it's an answer to the first question raised, which was about, well, had foreign films been shown here? Because if there were 14 or 15 cinemas in 1910, and there was no Ottoman cinema, then they were seeing foreign films.
Yeah, foreign films, this foreign, in cinema, interestingly, occupation forces or before the occupation forces, Ottoman or German or other forces, actually didn't ban the cinema so much. I mean, if this cinema, if the films were not about politics, it doesn't matter who produced this film. Probably during this time, people or politicians or other powers could see cinema as entertainment rather than politics, rather than ideological apparatus, I don't know.
What's the question, Lisa?
So my question would be about the contents of the film. It's like Vijayan Effendi is very similar, is a kind of a similar character to Charlie Chaplin.
Yes.
And I'm wondering if any films of Charlie Chaplin were shown in Istanbul. I mean, like in February 1940s, the first time he appeared in the film. And do we have any reports about it?
Max Linders and other comic figures were shown to the Ottoman audience. And after 1917, Charlie Chaplin movies entered the Ottoman world. And also, interestingly, there is another topic. I found Charlie Chaplin animation produced in the Western world, probably in the United States, okay, in 1919. And it was conveying some orientalist approach. If you have time, I can show it.
Yeah, I'm going to see it.
Okay. One thing, in 1923, Greta Garbo was here, and the Turkish customs confiscated her film. Is that film in any archive now? Is it, can it be found anywhere?
About 1923?
Yes.
There were some... unfortunately, during the fire happened in 1951 or 1952 in Ankara, many archive was destroyed. But it is not only about Turkey or Ottoman world, but also all around the world. Many films produced during the silent era was destroyed. We don't find.
What was the fire?
I mean, in Ankara, a film archive.
In the film archive?
Yeah, in Ankara. But it doesn't mean that we can find other films or new films. Over time, we will find many movies. I am not sure, but generally speaking, all over the world, many films produced during the silent time were destroyed, were lost. We cannot find many of them. This is, if you have time, I can show Charlie. Charlie, yes. I hope.
Who are the ladies in the film? Who are the actresses in the film?
Animation. Animation. But it is about Turkey. It is about Ottoman world.
And the years? The year, yes.
1919.
Do we know the name of the animation?
Yes. But first of all, I have to find it. Charlie in Turkey. But it's interesting because there is no Turkey country, there is Ottoman country, I mean, this is another issue. These are other films, Imperator Len and Sultan Ahmet. I didn't have time. But if you wish, I can send it.
Yeah, sure. I'll send you an email.
Maybe you can share this film to other people.
Okay. Was that said at Samadhi also, the scriptwriter?
Excuse me, sir, there are many questions from the back also.
Do you know anything about film screening in other Ottoman cities, like in Izmir or maybe elsewhere?
Cemil Filmer, who shot the demonstration films, demonstration film in Sultanahmet, I read the memory of the Cemil Filmer. He was filmmaker and owner of some movie theaters. He was interesting guy, and he wrote about the cinema and cinema period. Actually, the book is about the memory of the Cemil Filmer. And as far as I know, according to Cemil Filmer, there are some places like Izmir, which made screening of the films. And many people were very enthusiastic about seeing the many films. Izmir was a distinguished place other than Istanbul. But in Anatolia, to be honest, I don't have so much information. I was curious about cinema history 8 years ago. Now I gave up these issues. I have some books and articles about the Ottoman cinema, but as far as I remember, there is not so much information about this. Yes, sir.
Do you have any idea what was the average ticket price in the same film in Istanbul? Also, a second question maybe, can I ask it? Can I ask it together? There was mentioned, as I remember, 5,000 liras for the abroad screening.
Yeah.
And this abroad, is it
England? England. England.
Which countries?
Yeah. England, but in the book of Nurullah Tilgen, which was written in 1950s or 1960s, I don't remember now. But maybe there are some missing. I mean, there are some wrong expression. But according to him, this film, I mean, Binnaz or Brebbia, was sent to United States also. Mm-hmm. He says it. But generally, the box office revenue was obtained from the screening in the British, England. And this first question, what was it?
Average ticket prices.
Okay. Four or five kurush, but it was not so much expensive. And also there is an advantage of screening in the movie theaters because there was no tax. There was no tax. That is why it is very, how can I say? It is very, they were making money.
It's profitable.
Because Cemil Filmer says that there was no tax and we were making money so much good. Yeah.
When was the first film school established in the Ottoman Empire or in Turkey?
Yes, according to my research, in 1922, Kazım Karabekir, Kazım Karabekir, gave a suggestion that we must set up some cinema schools. And Mustafa Kemal Atatürk accepted this offer. We have to set up cinema schools and we have to produce films. We have to spread movie to all around the country. But unfortunately, what was his name? Rıza Nur rejected this idea and it wasn't accepted. And the first cinema school in Turkey was set up in 1974. Mimar Sinan University, Mimar Sinan University Finance Cinema School. It is very late because during the 1930s, as far as I know, in Italy there were cinema schools And also during the 1930s in Iran, there were some schools, cinema schools. That is why Iranian cinema was developed. I believe that.
Yes.
Okay.
No question, just I'm thinking by myself. I'm struck, it's so parallel to the earliest key of gramophone in Turkey. It's the same time, exactly the same time.
Sorry, I cannot hear you.
The early history of cinema in the Ottoman Empire is obviously completely parallel to the history of gramophone. At the same time, maybe gramophone started some few years earlier, like 2, 3, 4 years earlier. New forms of entertainment, this new media becomes popular. I don't know, it's not a question, I'm just surprised to hear that. I didn't know.
Actually, I don't know.
It's the same time. It's exactly the same time. In fact, I mean, the countries of influence might be different. For example, from Germany was important.
Downstairs, yes.
Not that much.
Well, if there are no other pressing questions, please join me in thanking our speaker one more time.
Ama yani ben onun çok fazla şey olduğunu anlamadım. Sadece durmak.